Okay, so hello. Today we are here at the Buddha Center. And before we start, let's pay homage to the Buddha. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. And we are here at the Buddha Center, and it's always nice to be around here. It's a beautiful place, lots of nice sights and sounds. And so, today I will be starting reading on the Sakka-pañha Sutta. And this will be from our organization, zeromangalo.org. And I'll be sure to put the link below the video. I'm just looking at the text here. And I'll make sure to set up the camera so it looks nice. Let me just turn this around. If we go like, maybe if we do like this. This looks nice. Okay, not to waste too much time on the camera here. But yeah. And so it's always nice to remember Sakka. At least I think so. He's a Sutta-pañha. And he dwells up in the Tower Timsa heavens. As far as we know. Buddha's words for it. And so, let's just get into the text here. This is going to be the Sakka-pañha Sutta. And this is actually a talk given by the Venerable Mahāsī Sayādaw, which has been transcribed into text, so we can we have the chance now to go and listen to it or read it. So usually I just pick up a sutta where it's just, you know, the short version of the sutta. But today we're going to start on this Sakka-pañha. And this is going to be where we have a monk explaining in depth the word, the letter, and the meaning of the Dhamma. And so this is going to be a longer video, and that's also why I'm here at the Buddha Center in Second Life, because it's probably going to take a couple of hours to get through this one. And when we're done with this one, I already have two other texts that I want to look at, so, and I can't really wait much longer to get into the text. So without further ado, let's just get the foreword here, and let me check the stream just to see that everything is alright. It seems to be fine. Okay. Oh! We're gonna make this incense light up. And there's also the three candles there. Just make sure this incense gets going. Oh, there it goes. Given an offering of incense to the Buddha. And so, let me pull up the text here. The Sakka-pañha, the foreword. This, let me just get it over here in the middle of the screen. This is the abridged translation of the Venerable Mahāsī Sayādaw's discourse on the Sakka-pañha Sutta. This discourse was given in December 1977 at the request of Yu Puint Kaung, the president of the Buddhasasana Nukaha organization, on the occasion of the annual gathering of Buddhist devotees who came from all over Myanmar to pay respect to the Sayadaw and hear his teaching. The president who requested the Venerable Sayadaw to give a Buddhist sermon that would be universally applicable, and therefore Mahāsī Sayādaw chose to give a series of talks on the Sakka-pañha Sutta, which was in fact the subject of a manuscript that he had been preparing for publication. The sutta tells us about the Buddha's dialogue with Sakka, the king of devas, and his penetrating analysis of the causes of conflicts, frustrations, and sufferings that beset all living beings. The Sayadaw rightly described the sutta as the Buddha's talk on world peace, and indeed it has an important message for people all over the world. The Venerable Sayadaw's discourse on the sutta is much informative and illuminating. Many of his observations are essential to the proper understanding and practice of the Dhamma. Thus, according to the Sayadaw, the introduction to a sutta is not as important as its central teaching. It serves to establish the authenticity of the sutta, but as in the case of the Abhidhamma Pitaka, its absence does not necessarily cast doubts on the origin of a Buddhist teaching. The melodious recitation of the scriptures, as is customary among some Buddhist preachers, and the mass slaughter of animals for food at pagoda festivals are to be deprecated in that such practices run counter to the teachings of the Buddha. No less incompatible with the spirit of the Dhamma is the fondness for lengthy prayers, which probably stem from the tendency to rely on external help rather than effort for the attainment of one's object. Apart from these passing remarks on matters of general interest to the Buddhists, the Sayadaw's discourse on the essence of the Buddhist teaching in the Sakka-pañha Sutta is superb. It is based on rational observations, anecdotes and teachings in the Pitakas and commentaries. The Sayadaw's clarification of the wholesome sorrow, wholesome depression, etc. will certainly inspire the yogis who are in low spirits because of lack of spiritual progress. His other explanations will also enlighten those who do not have much knowledge of the Dhamma or much experience in vipassana practice. The importance of Sakka-pañha Sutta as expounded by Mahāsī Sayādaw is not confined to Buddhists, or for that matter to a particular segment of world population. It concerns the whole of mankind, as well as all other beings in the universe, and those who practice it diligently may rest well assured of the end of suffering. Piku Indaka. Nyangang. I'm sorry, I can't pronounce the name. Nyangang. Mahāsī Dhammakatika. And so that was the foreword. And the stream looks to be alright. And so here we go. Discourse on the Sakka-pañha Sutta, substance of the Sutta. Sakka in Buddhist literature is a name given to the king of devas, and pañha means question. So Sakka-pañha Sutta is the discourse on the welfare of living beings which the Buddha gave in response to the questions of the king of devas. Sakka asked the Buddha as follows. Lord, there are devas, human beings, asuras, nāgas, gandhabbas, and many other living beings. These beings wish to be free from quarrels, armed conflicts, animosity, and unhappiness. Yet they are not free from these evils of life. What is the fetter, samyojana, that makes them unable to fulfill their desire? Here the devas referred to are apparently the Katumaharaja and Tawatimsa devas, for these devas were well known to Sakka. Asura devas were originally the enemies of Tawatimsa devas, who battled with them as mentioned in the Dachaka and other suttas. Formerly, they lived in Tawatimsa heaven, but while they were drunk, they were hustled down by Sakka to the foot of Mount Meru. The Nagas were a species of serpents who could work wonders with their psychic powers. The Gandhabbas were a kind of Katumaharaja devas who excelled in dancing, playing, music, and other cultural activities of the deva world. Then there were yakas, a kind of monster-like devas, animals, and so forth. These devas, human beings and other beings of the sensual world, have their heart in the right place. They wish to be free from hatred. They do not wish to bear a grudge and ill-treat others, or to become the enemies of other people. Nor do they wish to be ill-treated or to be forced to pay money. In short, all living beings long for security, peace, freedom, and happiness. Yet they are now all beset with danger, misery, and suffering. What is the fetter that causes this situation? Today we hear of the universal clamor for world peace and welfare of mankind. Ours will indeed be a happy world if we realize these ends. But the fact is that these hopes of mankind are still far from being realized, and this naturally raises the question of the cause of our frustration. In his reply, the Buddha describes Issa and Macharya. Macharis. In his reply, the Buddha described Issa and Machyaris as the two fetters that lead to the unhappy plight of humanity. Issa is envy. They create ill will against those who excel us. Machyarya is meanness that makes us reluctant to see others as prosperous as ourselves. It is these two fetters of envy and meanness that frustrate us and give rise to quarrel, enmity, danger, and misery. Those who envy a man because of his prosperity, affluence, possession, of a great number of attendants and high official position will be unhappy. However, they may talk about their desire for inner peace. They are unhappy because they harbor evil designs against the object of their envy. Needless to say, the object of one's evil design becomes one's enemy and vice versa. Many people suffer because of their envy, and no doubt this envy will subject them to suffering beyond redemption throughout their samsaric existence. Again, meanness or machyarya leads to conflict despite your desire to avoid it. You chafe at any person acquiring or using your property. You resent close relationships between your beloved one and another person. This is obvious in the case of married couples. Officials are unhappy when they have to face the prospect of their jurisdiction passing on to others. And so, machyarya gives rise to enmity, danger, worry, and misery. To sum up the Buddha's reply, the root cause of envy and meanness is the six sense objects which like or dislike and discursive thinking about them, which we like or dislike and discursive thinking about them. The remedy is to watch all phenomena arising from the six senses. Avoid unwholesome thoughts and entertain wholesome thoughts. This, then, is the substance of the sutta. Now, a few words about the introduction to the sutta. And, oh, just be back just in a second. Okay. So, let me just see here. We've reached the introduction here. Okay, introduction. The introduction to the sutta tells us where, why, to whom, and by whom the discourse was delivered. Thus, it serves to establish the authenticity of the Buddha's teaching. Without it, the origin of a sutta is open to question, as in the case of Abhidhammapitika, which has no such introduction. The Abhidhamma was preached in Tawatimsa heaven by the Buddha. At that time, the Buddha went daily to the Himalayan forest to take rest. At that time, the Buddha went daily to the Himalayan forest to take rest in the daytime, leaving his praxi, the Nimitta Buddha, to carry on the teachings regularly. The Buddha gave Thera Sariputta a summary of the Abhidhamma that he had taught for the day. The chief disciple in turn preached it to 500 monks. So the Abhidhamma is ascribed to Sariputta. But as the commentary says, since he heard it from the Lord, it is the teachings of the Buddha. The Abhidhamma Pitaka has no introductory statement such as Ewang me sutang, thus have I heard. Hence, according to the commentary, some did not accept it as the true teachings of the Buddha. In order that prosperity might have no doubt about the In order that posterity might have no doubt about the authenticity of the Buddha's teaching, most of those canonized at the first Buddhist council have introductions based on the questions and answers among the leading theras of the assembly. And theras means elders. The exceptions are the Dhammapada and a few other suttas. The introduction to the Sakka-pañha Sutta is superb, and it makes the sutta impressive and points up to the substance of the Buddha's teaching. In order to record such an important event, Mahakasapa asked Ananda where, to whom, and why the sutta was preached, and the latter answered as follows. Once the Buddha was dwelling in a cave that lay east of Rajagaha city in Magadha's country. At that time, Sakka sought to see the Buddha. He had seen the Lord on the eve of his supreme enlightenment, and at other times in Jetavana monastery at Sawati. As he was then not yet spiritually mature, the Buddha did not give him any interview. Now, Sakka decided to see the Lord with his retinue of devas, because he hoped to hear the sermon which the Lord might preach to someone among his followers who was worthy of liberation. But it was largely his fear of death that aroused his strong desire to see the Buddha. For being aware of the approaching end of his life, he was anxious to have something to rely upon for his salvation. When a deva is about to pass away, there appear 5 signs. 1. The flowers on his head wither away. 2. His garments become dirty and outworn. 3. The devas, who have never sweated before, sweat from the armpits when their end is near. 4. Their youthful appearance gives way to signs of old age. 5. Finally, they become weary of life in the last week of their existence. Having seen these 5 signs, Sakka thought of his imminent death and became much depressed. To get over his depression, he decided to go and see the Lord and hear the Dhamma. Then he instantly appeared with a retinue of devas near the residence of the Buddha. According to the commentary on the Visuddhimagga, it took Sakka and his followers no longer than the stretching or bending of a hand to move from Tawatimsa heaven to Magadha country. As Mahatika says, the phenomena that arise in one place and pass away in the same place. They do not pass on to another place. I'm sorry. I'm just gonna start that one over. As Mahatika says, the phenomena that arise in one place pass away in the same place. They do not pass on to another place. The yogi who watches the bending and stretching according to Satipatthana method is aware of the passing away of phenomena for several times in an instant. Just as the psychophysical phenomena arise and pass away instantly, so also the devas reached Magadha country through the successive flux of nama rupa within a split second. This was due to divine power or kamma jiti that gives the devas speed, a speed which is far greater than that of modern rockets or spaceships. So maybe like speed of light or beyond that. Sakka wanted to seek the Buddha's permission for his visit. So he told Panchasika Deva to go and find out where the Lord was whether the Lord was well disposed to welcome him. In Sakka's statement, there occurs the word pasadiyasi, which literally means to make one cheerful. According to the commentary, it means to gratify a person and seek his consent. It is a Pali expression that ancient Indians used in speaking politely. It is somewhat like saying, like the saying of the jackal to the elephant in the Sanskrit work Hitupadesa. The jackal said, "My lord, kindly make your eyes clear," which means, says the expositor, "kindly help me or do me the favor." Okay, so in compliance with the request of Sakka, Panchasika went to the residence of the Buddha and, standing respectfully at a suitable distance from the Lord, he played his harp and sang songs about the Buddha, the Dhamma, the Sangha and the Arahats. The Buddha would not have approved of the Deva's way of honoring him with songs and music any more than he would have approved of some modern Myanmar Buddhist practices, such as the melodious recitation of Pali scriptures, holding pagoda festivals on big scale, killing a lot of animals for food on festive occasions, and so forth, practices that do disservice to the Buddhist religion. But the Buddha said nothing, as he knew that his dialogue with Sakka would benefit many people. Some of Panchasika's songs were sensual in character, for his songs describe his infatuation for a beautiful goddess that had made him almost crazy. His frustration shows that the deva world does not guarantee the fulfillment of all your desire, and that the life of a deva is not always a bed of roses. His songs also contain references to the Buddha, the Arahat, and the good deeds he had done on earth. He speaks of the Bodhisatta, who is always mindful, absorbed in jhana, and bent on nibbana. Here, jhana means watching, and the object which one watches may be the object of concentration, or it may be the nature of mind and body, such as impermanence, etc. After giving up self-mortification, the Bodhisattva resorted to breathing exercise and attained jhana. These jhanic attainments center on a single object of attention and may last a couple of hours. Though the power of his jhana, the Bodhisattva, while sitting under the Bo tree, became aware of previous existences in the early part of the night. Pu-bini-wa-san-na-na. At midnight he attained the divine eye, Dipa-chakku, that enabled him to see the passing away and coming into existence of all beings in the universe. In the last part of the night, the Bodhisattva reflected on dependent origination and attained insight into the arising and dissolution of nama-rupa while seeing, hearing, etc. This constant mindfulness of the nature of existence is a mark of a mature wisdom, but it does not seem to be well known to Pañca-sikka-deva. He knew only that the Bodhisattva constantly reflected and was bent on the deathless amata, nibbana. The word amata comes from the Sanskrit amrita, which means deathlessness, and so amata refers to the deathless of nibbana. Questioned by the Buddha as to the origin of his songs, Pañca-sikka said that he had composed them for serenading his beloved goddess. The goddess was so much pleased with his songs about the Buddha that she allowed him to spend a day with her, a favor which she did not grant him again. Distraught and frustrated over his unrequited love, the deva gave vent to his feelings in his songs. Here the deva was not different from the ordinary person who is so much overwhelmed with desire that he cannot think rationally. Once the disciple of a famous Sayadaw left the holy order following an affair with a woman. His followers blamed the couple, but the Sayadaw admonished them thus, You should not blame them. They have come to such a pass under the pressure of their craving, so you should blame their craving. This is indeed a realistic teaching. When the deva paid respect to the Buddha on behalf of his master, the Lord wished Sakka happiness both in body and mind. The Buddha expressed this wish because all living beings want to be happy. That is the way the Buddha himself blessed those who worshipped him. There is no prayer in the words of Sakka when he expressed adoration of the Buddha through the deva, but by the Pali words Appivadeti, appivandati, vandati. We are to understand that he expected to be assured of happiness. In other words, he hoped that the Buddha would say, "May you be happy." The Buddha blessed other devotees in the same way. This gives us food for thought on the modern practice of giving a lot of blessings as a reward for mere devotion. The devotee prays for many things, but his prayer is often at odds with effusive blessings of the officiating monk. In fact, it is not necessary for the devotee to say anything further After expressing his reverence for the three jewels, Tiratana, not that there are some things for which you should not pray, but there should be no incongruity between the prayer and the blessing, since the monk usually mentions all the benefits accruing to one who performs a good deed. All that he or she has to do is to express the desire to have them. In paying respect to the Buddha, Sakka did not pray for anything, but he was assured of the due benefits as mentioned in the words Appi Vandana Sili Sannicchang, etc. So it will do as well for the devotees to pray just for longevity, health, and security, and the monk should bless them accordingly. He should not act like someone decreeing the fulfillment of their wishes, but only as someone contributing to it. Now, Sakka and his followers came to pay respect to the Buddha. Sakka said that despite his ardent desire to see the Lord, he had been unable to do so because of his preoccupation with the affairs of the devas. He told the Lord how his experience accorded with what he had heard before. It was said that the deva population increased when there appeared a Buddha. He had now found that this was true. Following the Buddha's preaching of the Dhammacakkappavattana Sutta, some observed the five precepts, some gave alms, and most of them attained the deva world after death. At the very least, those who had faith in the Buddha were assured of rebirth in the deva world. This was the view which the Buddha did not reject when it was expressed by Brahma. Faith in the Buddha means faith in the Dhamma and the Sangha, and as such it ensures protection from rebirth in the lower worlds. Moreover, even almsgiving to the worthy disciples of the Buddha carry more karmic weight than any other act of dana. Thus, a deva, who as a lay follower of the Buddha in his previous existence had given a spoonful of rice to an arahant, was more powerful than another deva who, while on earth, had fed many people gratis, free for many years. Out of about 100 million people in the middle Ganges Valley, the original home of Buddhism, about 80 million people might have been Buddhists, with the exception of arhats and those at the anagami stage. A large number of these Buddhists might have attained the deva world. This probably accounts for the rise in the deva population in those days. Then Sakka narrated the story of Gopaka. A princess in Sawadi city named Gopaka had much faith in the Buddha and observed the five precepts strictly. She loathed womanhood and wished to be a man. After death, she became the son of Sakka and was called the Gopaka. One day, Gopaka saw three gandhabbas who came to entertain Sakka. He found out that they were formerly three monks who he had supported. He wondered why they were now reborn as a low-class deva despite their commitment to the holy path in their previous lives, whereas he himself, a mere woman in his past existence, had become the son of Sakka by virtue of his faith and morality. The three gandhabbas then recalled their past lives. They realized that their rebirth in the lower order of devas was due to the craving for the world of gandhabbas. Two of the devas practiced meditation and attained anagami stage in a moment. The other deva was, however, unable to overcome his sensual attachment, so he remained stuck up in his lowly life. Here, renewal of existence as gandhabba due to attachment to a formal life of the same kind is especially noteworthy. People are likely to be reborn in their native place and environment, which have special influence over them. The three monks we have mentioned are no exception in this respect. King Bimbisara, who adored the Buddha, gave alms to the Sangha liberally for 37 years, became after his death a subordinate of Katumaharaja Deva. He could have attained a higher Deva world, but for his attainment in the previous lives. This leaves no doubt about the need for overcoming attachment to one's native place. The two devas attained jhana as a result of their reflection on the Dhamma that they practiced in their past lives, and through meditation they reached anagami stage on the holy path. You need not to be disheartened for lack of success in meditation, for persistent effort will certainly lead to rebirth in heaven. There, you are assured of unusual spiritual experience if you remember and continue to practice the Dhamma. For as the Sutta in Anguttara Nikaya says, the body of a deva is pure and radiant, and the Dhamma becomes clear to the deva who practiced it in his previous life. It may take time to recollect it, but recollection is instantly followed by attainment of insight knowledge. Some may forget it because of heavenly pleasure, but devas, they are physically and mentally alert, and once they turn their attention to the Dhamma through reflection or sermons, they understand and attain insight in a short time. If the yogis who strive for spiritual experience do not have it in this life, they will certainly have it in the deva world. As the deva world teems with sensual pleasure, those who have attained anagami stage cannot stay there, and so they pass on to the Brahma world instantly. For Sakka, the transformation of the two devas into Brahmas right under his eyes was indeed impressive. When he heard Gopaka's explanation, he wished to share their spiritual experience. Moreover, the signs of his imminent death fueled his desire for the life of a Brahma. If he heard the Dhamma, he might have a better future life, even if he did not attain any insight. Hearing the Dhamma is indeed the best thing a deva can do on his deathbed. Wow, that was an awesome story. Where Sakka, he just sees these two devas instantly become Brahmas, giving up all sensual pleasure. The reason they're born in the Brahma world is because an anagami is the third class of an enlightened being, and the fourth being an arahant. And an arahant is a fully enlightened being, and an anagami is still clinging to the view of self. And that's why they take birth in the Brahma world, because of the delusion of an I. And so an arahant, they don't go to the Brahma worlds, they go to Nibbana. Awesome. Okay, so let me just see here. 45 minutes. And we're now... Okay, so we just reached next chapter here called Sakka's Questions on the and the Buddha's Answers. And I think we should just read this one and maybe see if we're gonna take the next one as well before we cut the video up into part one. So, continuing on. Sakka's Questions and the Buddha's Answer. Sakka first sought the Buddha's permission to ask questions. It is customary for a highly cultured being to get permission before making an inquiry. Then Sakka asked the following question. Lord, all living beings wish to be free from anger and ill will. They do not want to quarrel or to be ill-treated. They pray for happiness, security, peace, and freedom. Yet, they are not free from danger and suffering. What is the cause of this situation? The Buddha answered, O King of Devas, all living beings long for happiness, security, peace, and freedom. Yet they are not free from hatred, conflicts, danger, and suffering. This unhappy condition of living beings is due to the fetters of envy, issa, and miserliness, macharya. The characteristic of envy is aversion to the prosperity and welfare of others, which makes one malicious and destructive. These evil desires give rise to suffering here and now, as well in the future life of the person who harbors them. They also lead to the suffering of those who are envied. All over the world, it is envy that causes much suffering. This envious person hates to see happy of prosperous people. Hence, the characteristic of envy is dislike of other persons' welfare. Its function, rasa, is to make the envious person miserable, and its phenomenon that strikes us on reflection, pachupatana, is shutting one's eyes to another person's welfare. One who is dominated by envy does not want to see another person's prosperous, successful, good-looking, educated, or promoted to high official position. Envy is indeed an evil, which does not benefit in any way the person who harbors it. It provides a fertile soil. Bad karma, and makes one miserable. A powerful man will seek to ruin the person whom he envies, and by so doing he turns the other into his enemy, who may pay him back in kind. Even if there is no danger of retaliation, he will surely suffer in the afterlife. The Chula Kamavibhanga Sutta sums up the karmic consequences of envy as impotency and dearth of attendance. If you want to listen to the Chula Kama Vibhanga Sutta, I have a video on that on my YouTube channel. So you can find that right now. Some men, and the Chula Kama Vibhanga Sutta is a sutta where the Buddha gives answers to questions such as what makes one intelligent, what makes one beautiful, what makes one ugly, what makes one attain a high birth, what makes one attain a low birth, what makes one stupid, and what makes one wealthy, and what makes one poor. And all these kinds of questions the Buddha answered when a layman came and asked the Buddha for his advice. So check that one out here at my YouTube channel. Okay, continuing on. Some men and women do not want to hear anything about the good fortunes of another person, his wealth, affluence, intelligence, eloquence, good health, or popularity. They say or do things detrimental to the person's interest. Propaganda in modern times is motivated by envy. The envy-ridden person suffers in hell for many years, and after his release from there, he is reborn in the human world. He becomes a man of low birth with few attendants and little reputation. On the other hand, one who rejoices at the good fortune of another person has goodwill. He is happy when he sees or hears of another man's prosperity. He helps to promote others' welfare as much as possible, and thereby cultivating much good karma. He attains the deva world after death, enjoys a happy life, and on return to the human world, he is powerful and has many followers. So those who wish to prosper in the present life and hereafter should overcome envy and cultivate mudita, sympathetic joy, or empathetic joy. Or in other words, rejoice at the welfare of other people. And so I also have a playlist that I named Love, I'm pretty sure, and that talks about the four sublime states, or the four infinite states, which is 1, metta, 2, metta is loving-kindness, and 2, karuna, and karuna is compassion, or wishing for no harm to come to another being, or others. And 3 is mudita, or sympathetic joy, and 4 is upekkha, equanimity. And so you can look up my series of talks on love, as these four infinite states protects and keeps the mind calm and at ease. And I'm gonna take this chapter as well. Macharya, miserliness. Macharya is miserliness to the point of keeping one's possessions secret. It does not want others to have anything to do with the objects of one's attachment. It is characterized by extreme possessiveness. Extreme possessiveness is a characteristic of miserliness, macharya. Macharya. It is of five kinds according as it relates to 1, dwelling, 2, friends and intimates, 3, material things. 4. Material goods. 5. Commendable attributes. And 6. Learning. So in these 6 ways does miserliness relate. And again, 1. Dwelling. 2. Friends and intimates. 3. Material things. 4. Material goods. 5. Commendable attributes. And 6. Learning. The first kind of macharya is to be found among some monks who do not want to see other monks of good moral character dwelling in their communal monastery. A monk may not want his lay followers to give alms food to other monks. Such envious monks have to undergo many kinds of suffering after death because of their ill will. Vanya macharya machariva is the desire to possess a special quality such as physical beauty exclusively and to begrudge those who have the same quality. It may lead to ugliness as a karmic consequence. Again, it is the Dhamma macharya to begrudge a person his learning or to keep back any knowledge from him. Any knowledge. This macharya may make its victim a moron or an idiot in the afterlife. Thus, macharya over the good fortune of other people makes a man unhappy, poor, friendless, and subject to much suffering after death. Asava macharya largely concerns the bhikkhus. It is the tendency to regard the sanghika, the communal monastery, as one's private residence, and for the laymen and women it is the tendency to have a similar attitude in regard to public religious building such as temples, meditation retreats, and so forth. Kula macharya dominates those monks who do not want their lay followers to have close relations with other monks. Some monks forbid their disciples to see other monks or to hear their sermons. As for the lay people, it is macharya to insist on the undivided and exclusive loyalty of one's followers. Asava macharya was what we just heard of. This is extremely bad behavior. And there are actually a lot of bad monks out there, unfortunately. And since it's almost 2550 something years since the Buddha passed, so probably most of the good monks around, they have gone to Nibbana. So we should strive diligently and be virtuous, as the Buddha reminds us. Continuing on. Lapa macharya of some monks is the desire to have a monopoly of alms and to deny them to good monks. As an example of the samsaric suffering rooted in this evil, there is the story of Losakatissa. In the lifetime of Kassapa Buddha, which was the Buddha before Gautama Buddha, our present Buddha, There lived a monk in a certain village. He depended on a lay disciple for the necessities of life. One day, another monk came and put up his monastery. Fearing that his disciple's reverence for the new arrival might become a threat to his security, the resident monk tried to get rid of his guest. When the disciple invited both of them to have meals at his house, he went there alone, and on his return he dumped by the wayside the food that had been offered for the visiting monk. And so the reason that he dumped this food was because he had the thought that if he gave it, I mean, if this new monk ever saw this food, he would be too infatuated and he would never leave again. And so this horrible monk, horrible excuse of a monk, decided to toss the food away and not give alms to his good monk guest. And that was just my own words on it. Continuing. On his death, he suffered for eons in hell, and from there he passed on to the animal world, where he suffered extreme hunger for many lifetimes. And then he probably went back to hell. In his last existence, okay, here we go. In his last existence, he was reborn in a fisherman's village in Kosala country. From the time of his conception, misfortunes befell the villages and his parents. At last, the pangs of hunger made his mother so desperate that she abandoned the child while he was out begging. Then Thera Sariputta saw the starving child. Moved with pity, the Thera took the child to his monastery, where some years later he became a bhikkhu. He was called Thera Lokatissa because he was so unlucky that he never had a square meal even at a great feast. All he got was barely enough to sustain life. This karmic evil dogged him even when he attained arahatship. Shortly before his parinibbana, Sariputta took him to Sawati city to see to it that he had a square meal on the last day of his life. It is said that there was then no one to offer food to the Thera. He therefore sent his companion to a rest house. Then the disciples offered food, some of which he sent to Lokatissa, but the men who took the food ate it up on the way. So the Thera himself had to bring the food and hold the bowl while the bhikkhu ate it. In this way, Lokatissa had his last meal and passed away on that very day. This story leaves no doubt about the frightful karmic consequences of macharya. Many kinds of macharya afflict lay people, as for example, lapa macharya, in the case of those who seek to monopolize a lucrative business, vanya macharya, of those who do not recognize the good attributes of others, Dhamma macharya, of those who do not wish to share their knowledge with any other person. The Buddha's statement attributing mankind's unhappiness to envy and ill will was directly relevant to Sakka. For in this view of his approaching end, he was unhappy over the prospect of his wife's falling into the hands of his successor. At the thought of the latter outshining him, so from experience, He realized the truth of the Buddha's answer and asked another question. Let's keep going now. Discourse on Sakka-pañha Sutta, Love and Hatred. Lord, what is the cause of envy and ill will? What is the cause that we must remove in order to be free from them? And the Buddha answered, O King of Devas, envy and ill will are caused by objects of love and hatred. If there were no such objects, there would be no envy and no ill will. The Buddhist way to the end of suffering is to remove its cause. It is like the treatment of a disease by a competent physician who seeks its cause and eliminates it. The Buddha points out love and hatred as the cause of mankind's unhappiness. Objects of love are living and non-living objects that please us, such as men, women, sight, sounds, and etc. And objects of hatred are those which displease us. We envy a person whom we dislike, but who owns valuable objects. Ill will plagues us when we wish to deny to others the objects of our attachment. And so, envy and ill will have their roots in hatred. So, envy and ill will have their roots in hated persons and cherished objects. The object of our envy is usually one whom we hate. If a person who excels us happens to be our beloved one, it is a cause not for envy but for joy. A boy who outshines his parents does not excite envy in them. On the contrary, they will pride themselves on his superior qualities. The man who has ill will, macharya, or miserliness, wants to deny to others the kind of wealth that he has, the use of his goods and association with his friends. So the jealous men and women frown on their spouses who have close relationships with members of the opposite sex or even engage in friendly conversation. In short, macharya is the desire to be excessively possessive. So here we have it. Let me just read that again. In short, macharya is the desire to be excessively possessive. To oppose any close contact between one's cherished objects and other people, and so it is rooted in love and hatred. Okay, so I think we're just gonna get one more. The next paragraph here. I don't know what to call it. There's like a little title here. It goes like this: desire as the cause of love and hatred. So I think we're gonna end this here. And then part two, we're going to start off with desire as the cause of love and hatred. Yeah, so probably we're going to do it like that. Because that would be a nice way to actually get into the next part of this sutta. And if we can end off here, just knowing and having learned what macharya is, which was, in short, the desire to be excessively possessive, then I think we have learned something very valuable for today. And I will try and make part 2 to this video, maybe start it in just a few minutes, and hopefully I can get 2 parts up today. And so thank you so much for listening, and make sure to check out the text below. The link for the text is below. And thank you for listening and your attention, and please come back and listen to part 2, and we will be sure to go through the full talk as given by the Venerable Mahāsī Sayādaw. And so, once again, thank you, and may you find true peace, happiness, and freedom from suffering. Namo Buddhassa.